What's up, guys? Mike's here, and I'm going to read another chapter of Incognito. And, everything is fine, but now everything has been changed. I mean, a lot lately. And, you know, sometimes what is all going down must come down. And that's what I have been told. I've been told by myself. And let's get started with chapter 8 of Ruby, and we'll see how far it could get. Chapter 8. Here we go. Pyrrha wasn't entirely sure what had led her to this point in her life. Having always lived in Minstrel, she never imagined that she would one day find herself in Vale. There had never really been any reason for her to go. Minstrel was where she had made her entire life, her family, her home. She had never been one to believe in destiny, at least not as force that was beyond your control, leaving you stranded on a predetermined path. There were simply too many variables that she had the potential to influence, too much power resting in her very hands. One seemingly minute decision could alter her path entirely. She had seen herself firsthand. If she'd never agreed to take modeling jobs, she never would have found herself growing restless, waiting throughout the day between shoots. Had she not been overcome by this desire to make the time pass faster, she probably wouldn't have resorted to reading X-Ray and Vab comics. Had she not taken an interest in that series, to the extent that she was avidly following and taking and talking about it online, she might not have ever met John. Still, regardless of what had drawn her here to this extract precise moment, Pyrrha knew that she was thankful. Thankful to have seen this part of the world. Thankful that this opportunity had presented itself. Thankful that this was how the chips had fallen for her. As she stood in front of the door to Weiss's house, it was becoming increasingly difficult to concentrate on unlocking the door as Johnson's arms surrounded her and he moved to kiss her neck. She drew her head back unconsciously, offering more skin for him to lavish. Caught in an impasse between the overbearing pleasure consuming her and the struggle to make it inside, she didn't want this private, affectionate moment to publicly showcase, after all. Eventually, the door sprang open and the two stumbled clumsily inside, almost losing their balance. Despite slipping, they did not make any attempt to separate. Pyrrha nudged the door closed with her foot and pulled John further in the house. She gasped as he pressed her up against the wall, bracing her between the hard foundation and solid warmth of his chest. Her lips were caught against his, and she was enraptured by a strength she had never known John to possess. There was an invigorating feeling coating her body in the heat of their exchange, like an adrenaline. She could feel her heartbeat pounding erratically, the reverberation building, traveling up to the shell of her ear, though she didn't feel nervous. For, in this new sensation, there was also a comfort, a familiarity in the person who was sharing it with her. Pyrrha was chaste, inexperienced when it came to romantic endeavors. Yet, something that may have seemed daunting to her with any other person somehow seemed perfectly natural with John. She trusted him. It wasn't until she felt his tongue graze against her lip as her fingers worked their way beneath the hem of his hoodie that her eyes flickered open with a start, and she became abruptly conscious of exactly where they are and what they were doing. Weiss could be back at any minute now. If she weren't home already, and Pyrrha wasn't entirely sure how she would be able to explain herself if they were caught in their current position. Not to mention, on a more serious note, they were still barely one day moved from the death of Ruby's mother. John was yet to hear back from his friend, and she knew how sick with concern he felt. What they were doing, it just didn't seem very appropriate. When Pyrrha had kissed her as much as Pyrrha wanted to believe, it was the grandiose moment in which he finally confessed his love for her. She knew how unlikely that was. John was feeling scared and confused. Surely, he was just turning to her to comfort in a moment of uncertainty. Something he had offered her without questioning the past. He may have come on too strong, but she could forgive him, given the headspace he was currently in. As much as it pained her, Pierre felt that they should stop before things escalated too far, before they reached a point from which there was no turning back. John, wait. She finally summoned the strength to gasp, the rational side of her managing to see through the pleasure clouding her consciousness. John's eyes widened at the desperation in her voice, and he pulled away her deftly, a guilt and tension suddenly weighing upon his expression. Pierre frowned, not missing his reaction. What is it, Pierre? John asked, his voice cracking. He cleared his throat, as if trying to mask his nerves. John, don't get me wrong. Pierre stammered, trying to collect her still clouded hazy thoughts. But are you sure that this is okay? Why would it be? John ventured, his hand scratched at the back of his head, tousling his mop of hair even more. It's just, we've known each other for so long. I thought things might be, different. Pierre's eyes traced the pristine, white walls around them as she considered John's words. He was right. Their relationship was different. While they had considered each other friends for the longest time, she would be lying too if she said that she didn't harbor an unspoken attraction towards him, a desire for something more. It was part of what made this so difficult. At an earlier point, when they lived apart, her feelings had seemed much easier to express. The distance between them had created a barrier that seemed impossible to breach. She could resign herself to accept that their situations, their very separate, very different lives, would make it impossible for any romance between them to work. That it was simply not meant to be, but that was fine. She was more than happy to be John's friend. That is, until the day she arrived in Vale. Nothing more stood between them except their sheer euphoria, the rush of being there within reach of one another. It was then that Pierre's feelings rose to surface, flaring more intensely than ever before. It was with a nervous sense of urgency, an invigoration that Pierre found herself now, with nowhere else to turn, and no choice but to confront the feelings she held inside. She understood that where she went from here, how she decided to act would ultimately shape their relationship from then on. They were tearing on the boundary between friendship and a greater unknown. It will only take one step in either direction to tip the scale. The thought alone seemed daunting, but she had been willing to take the risk. Just not like this. Oh, John sighed after a moment, reading Pierre's sense as this agreement. I guess I was wrong. Sorry, I didn't mean to make you uncomfortable. I'll see myself out. John, Pierre said, clasping his hand as he reached for the door. That isn't what I meant. John glanced hesitantly over his shoulder. What are you talking about? I didn't mean that you did anything wrong. I was just worried, that's all. Worried about what? I thought that after Ruby and her mother, you would still be in a bad place. I really care about you, John. And this, Pierre swallowed, resolving to speak the words that had remained lodged in her throat for so long. This, us, is something that I want. But I know that you can't be entirely the right frame of mind right now. I wouldn't ask for this unless I knew that you felt the same way. That it was what you wanted to. And with everything that's happened, I'm not entirely sure That's the case. Is that what you think this is? John asked, his hand gesturing between them. Pierre's ears burned, self-conscious over the implication of his words. Her gaze lowered again, and she could only nod in silence. John moved towards her slowly, his hands resting against her arms at either side. Pierre bit her lip, her head turning with a flicker of red hair. Resistant, John lowered his face to hers, nudging his forehead affectionately against her chin, as if coaxing her to look up at him. Yet Pierre refused. Her eyes remained fixed stubbornly to the floor. Pierre, please. Despite her silence, her sudden uncharacteristic aloofness, there was a fond smile lightening John's features as he watched her, a gesture indicative of the faith he placed in her. Pierre relented after a moment, her vibrant green eyes tracing the contours of John's chest before resting to meet his own. I like to think you may know well enough to know that I want to do something like this, unless I mean it, he whispered. Pierre could feel her heart rate picked up as John slinked closer, his hand stopping to rest against her bicep. She became powerless to move when John's lips hovered on her own, breath grazing against her as he spoke. But just in case you're not convinced. His eyes closing, John broke the last vestige of space that separated them, his mouth gently covering hers. This time she was able to revel in the sensation, to savor the soft pressure of John's lips and the tiny flutter that simmered through her chest. She was enraptured in the moment, able to experience and commit to memory each minute movement of their lips against one another's. Despite the boldness he had shown initially, there was a still degree of apprehension in John's touch. Apparently, much like her, he was self-conscious, not bolstered by the adrenaline that had flowed between them earlier. Still, he was gentle and sincere. It was with each reciprocation from Pierre that he grew steadily more confident in his exploration, hands cupping at her waist to pull her closer. As they eventually parted, John looked warmly into her eyes, silence permeating between them. Though he had not spoken, he had said all that he needed to. Really? Pierre whispered, after a moment, her disbelief apparent. Yeah. John nodded simply. Really? For how long? John paused, unsure of how to answer. There had never been a particular moment that stood out to him. Honestly, I think I've always felt this way to some degree. It was just never something I could act on before.
There was always this distance between us. But I could tell, once it was gone, once it was just you and me and I finally saw you, I would know for certain how I felt. His hand rose to cup her cheek, their gaze holding. But if you're worried at all, I don't mind taking things one step at a time, he said, his eyes lowered to their linked hands at his thumb, absently etched patterns into the back of her palm. I've waited years for this, Pierre. I'm sure holding out a little longer won't kill me. Stepping forward, Pierre wrapped her arms around John again. I think we both waited long enough.
That's the Arcos moment. Wow, I cannot believe this is Arcos moment. Let's just move to the next one. The site of their rally was an abandoned building in the outskirts of Mountain Glen, a part of Vale normally deserted. With their growing reputation, there were very few venues left in the city that would allow the White Fang to host an event. Judging by the emblem that been engraved into the side of the wall, Blake had a feeling they had resorted to claiming one as their own. The numbers were much greater than she recalled, flooding from the entrance in waves. It was just as she had feared, they were still growing. Their latest attack and its subsequent media coverage must have drawn them even more attention. Any publicity was good. Even the pieces that slandered or disparaged them still helping to spread their cause. It made Blake wonder how many people were genuinely believing in it. How many of them weren't just jumping ship out of fear to avoid being labeled an enemy. Standing in line, she couldn't help but feel conscious of her stance, her movement through the rallying crowd. She was afraid that someone might recognize her, or that even the slightest misstep would draw unwanted attention to herself. She kept her gaze level, drawn carefully to the new initiates waiting in front of her. As she willed herself to Brad Staley, there was no reason to be worried. It had been a long time. Surely no one would be able to pick her out of the entire crowd. She would have to call upon her old sub as much as possible, the one who had felt completely at home at these rallies, the young woman who had followed the White Fang on missions, raiding cargo trains, despite knowing she was stepping into dangerous waters, that some of them might come back alive. Back then, her heart would never quiver with fear, no matter what faced her down, it had been steel. With these memories fresh in her mind, the confidence and strength she derived from what she had already survived, Blake felt as though she would be ready to face down anything. Yet, as a hand grasped her from behind, roughly by the shoulder, Blake's confidence dissipated, her heart sinking in the back of her throat. Hey! Drawing on instincts, sharpened from years of exposure to the dangers outside of the kingdom, with fluid, succinct movement, Blake grabbed the hand of the man who trained her, flipping them over her shoulder in one deft motion. They clapped against the concrete with a strained grunt, not having expected the attack of bracing themselves for impact. Their masks scattered to the floor, exposing a shock of blonde hair and sharp dark eyes. Ugh, Blake, what the hell was that? Son yelled as he sat up, holding his rib. Son? Blake's eyes widened, voice hissing through her teeth. What are you doing here? I can ask you the same question, he challenged, retrieving his mask from the ground. That's none of your concern. Oh, really? Son drawled, standing back up to his feet. Here I thought seeing someone I knew hang outside of a terrorist group's hideout was a cause for concern. My mistake. Blake glared at Son, though, before she could answer him, she became conscious of the gazes lingering in their direction. Their relatively heated exchange had already drawn the attention of bystanders, who whispered to one another, suspicious. The last thing she needed was for her cover to be blown. She took Son's hand and pulled him away from the entrance, moving back into the shadows. Blake stopped in the middle of the nearby alley before turning her gaze towards Son. He flinched at the intensity of her glare, her eyes cutting through him. Why were you following me? Well, I... Son mumbled, looking away from her sheepishly. Son! Blake demanded, her tone sharp. I saw you leaving with that, he explained, gesturing towards her mask. I had a feeling I might find you here and what you might be planning. I know you're upset about what happened to Ruby's mother, but going after the White Fang yourself? That's not the answer. It's suicide. You won't understand. It's not just Ruby. There's more to it than that. A lot more. Besides, I'm not trying to fight them. I just want to know what's going on. Finding them, spying on them regardless, do you think the Fang's going to care when they find you? I know what I'm getting myself into, son. Probably a lot better than you do. Hey, I grew up in Baku. I know how to handle myself. So you're not leaving then. Not unless you're coming with me. No. Okay, fine. Blake decided. I guess I don't have any other choice. Just know, if you come with me, I don't want you to get in my way. Got it? Yes, ma'am. Sun smirked, saluting playfully. Blake rolled her eyes, moving towards the entrance of the club. As they approached, they couldn't help but notice that though the bulk of the key had dispersed, the door was not blocked. A white Fang member standing guard. Everything alright with you two? The guy's low, gravelly voice matched his build, gruff and intimidating. Blake flinched, relying on the cover of her mask to not give away her expression. The man's stance and the way he folded his muscular, tattooed arms spoke volumes of his suspicion. Some of the other new recruits must have warned him about their earlier behavior. Yeah, totally fine. Sun answered before she had a chance. Just a misunderstanding. Even from behind his mask, Blake could make out the way the Fang's members' eyes lingered on them deliberately. He wasn't entirely convinced, but had nothing concrete against them. Just the word of a few uninitiated members. The rally is about to start. It would be best if you made your way inside without causing any further disruption. We'll be sure to do that, Son answered. He stepped aside begrudgingly. Blake cursed, knowing that they weren't in the clear. He would be keeping an eye on them. Well, alright then. Son winked, extending his arm out to her. Lead the way! Blake rolled her eyes and moved around him, stepping into the main foyer. Through here. Pyrrha had always been told that she was good-looking, beautiful even. She had offered sponsorships and modeling deals over the years, her face gracing the cover of magazines and different products. Yet, despite the praise that had been showered upon her, she had never truly felt as beautiful, as desired, as loved, as she did in this moment. She was so content, so peaceful, resting against John's chest, surrounded by the warmth of his arms and lulled by the steady beat of his heart. Together, they drifted in and out of sleep, lips brushing intermittently, fingers tracing lacy patterns into one another's skin. She wasn't entirely sure how long they lay together like that. She could only remember being stared by the soft vibrations of John's voice. He sighed contentedly, stretching. I didn't realize how much time had passed. I should probably let Ren Nora know where I am. Okay, Pierre answered absently, readjusting herself against his chest. John looked down at her with a chuckle. Pyrrha, do you mind? Pyrrha's eyes flickered open, remembering that she was still lying against him, trapping one of his arms beneath her. Oh, right. I'm sorry. You don't have to apologize, John said, free to sit upright and fish his scroll out of his pocket. He sifted through his messages, eventually pulling one open with a sigh. I should probably head back. Nora and I did kind of promise we'd clean up after the party. Oh, Pyrrha answered, disappointed, lacing her voice. It didn't go unnoticed by John, who turned to her with a smile. I'm sorry, Pyrrha. You know, I wouldn't leave unless I had to. I know. Listen, if you're ever lonely, you're more than welcome to stay with us. Nora and Ren really seem to take a liking to you. Though the idea of staying over with John, specifically of more time sleeping in each other's arms, did seem appealing. There was still something Pyrrha needed to make clear. She thought that she had an idea. From the way he had held her and kissed her just moments ago, she hoped. But she wanted to know for certain. John, Pyrrha began, catching his hand before he rose to his feet. Before you go, can you tell me? What is it, Pyrrha? Where does this leave us now? What exactly are we? For the second time, John did not answer, choosing not to hinder himself with words. He moved forward, capturing her lips with his own. Pierce's breath caught in her throat at the way his hand cupped her chin. The gentle adoration that lingered in his eyes as they gradually separated. I'll see you around, Pyrrha. Hey, yeah, that's the end of that chapter. Wow, there's some Arcus' moments there. You finally caught that. You finally caught Arcus' moments that... Okay, because you know what? Here's the fact that you don't know about the Ruby. Because I'm a secretly fan of Arcus. I ship Arcus now because... Now I finally realize about what their story is about. And you know... The whole concept of it. Now I finally realize that, hey, this is good. This is a good shipping. I shipped it. It's OTP. It is my favorite shipping that I have on Ruby. Because, you know, it's a good thing. Pyrrha and... Oh, no. No, no, no. Yeah. Pyrrha and John. Yeah. Figured scare. It is a OTP. That's OTP for me. And it's one of my OTP shipments for that one. And as for right now, I really love it. I love them. It's a good shipping. I just, you know, that I finally realized it. Alright, that is the end of another chapter of Incognito, and I'll see you guys next time for another one. It's gonna be longer than it takes to get this thing started. Alright, see you next time. Bye.